A big change to Hungary came with the ascension of Géza the Grand, Prince of the Hungarians. Upon his ascension, Géza found himself under pressure. The neighboring Holy Roman Emperor had been solidifying and expanding his realm, and just recently the Byzantine Empire had pacified Bulgaria. Again. And most recently, the two emperors forged an alliance by marriage. You can see why most historians assume that Géza was worried. The external pressure sped up Géza's decision to accept Christianity. He sent a message to the Holy Roman Emperor to send him a priest. In exchange, he would renounce his claims to parts of the emperor's lands. The Holy Roman Emperor, pleased at this turn of events, sent for a monk called Bruno of St. Gallen, who was soon ordained as Bishop of the Hungarians. A bit more diplomacy followed, with Géza having his son Stephen marry the daughter of the Duke of Bavaria and sister to the future Holy Roman Emperor. Though Géza formally converted, it is known he continued to observe pagan custom. Some say that it was to appease the traditionalists, others accept the idea that Géza simply saw nothing wrong with worshipping both. He's quoted as saying, "I'm rich and powerful enough to do so." Géza also fought a bloody internal struggle for power. We don't know much about his family. Some assume it's because he killed most of them. The consolidation of power did leave a few survivors, notably a noble named Kopany, who ruled part of Transdanubia, and Gyula in Transylvania. Géza is described as a harsh and cruel ruler, but if we compare it to the description of his son Stephen, there appears to have been heavy manipulation in the chronicles, leading some to believe that Géza's legacy had been deliberately blackened in order to make Stephen's rule seem even better than it was. Upon Stephen's succession in 997, Kopany rose in rebellion against Stephen. Géza and now Stephen had obviously been transforming the realm in more than just a few aspects. It's noted that Stephen, and probably Géza before him, had invited skilled professionals from across Europe to help them build a more European kingdom. Among them were mercenaries and knights to organize a medieval fighting force. The new army of knights defeated Kopany. It is said that a German knight from Swabia killed him. Stephen had Kopany's body quartered and sent the quarters to the major settlements in his realm. One of the quartered pieces he sent to Gyula in Transylvania as a clear warning. After having pacified the realm, on Christmas Day of the year 1000, Stephen was crowned as King of the Hungarians. His crown coming with papal blessings and an imperial nod of approval. Stephen's rule would be marked with expanding royal authority. In 1003, the Gyulas in Transylvania submitted to Stephen, and another problematic ruler by the name of Aitoni was also taken care of. It is recorded that Stephen tried to become the model of a medieval Christian knight. The experts he invited included a corps of priests and monks who educated his expanding court and spread the Christian faith and who wrote for him new laws. This, of course, caused tensions with quite a few Hungarian pagan traditionalists. It is assumed that newly arrived Benedictine monks went into the country and demonstrated their practices of work and prayer to the common folk, bringing with them other innovations as well. Along with a new church organization into bishoprics and parishes, a new institution was born out of a need to control the Hungarian realm. Many knights, fighters, native Hungarians, or foreign-born, were assigned to organize themselves locally for what is loosely described as a garrison duty. Eventually, a lot of them would be given small parcels of land for upkeep, and that is how the story of the minor nobility starts. These minor nobles were organized into communities, municipalities, counties, parishes? Županije would be the Croatian term, but they also have naming variation depending on what they were garrisoning, who it belonged to. The Županije were organized administrative units for the minor nobility, led by a župan or ispán in Hungarian, who represented them at court. With time, the great Hungarian nobility will also start to formally organize, and in a few hundred years, we will refer to them as magnates when they become relevant. As in many realms, the king had a most trusted noble, and in Hungary, the right-hand man of the king was the Palatine, appointed by the king from among the nobility. Along with knights and priests, many other foreigners will start to arrive and inhabit the sparsely populated realm of the Hungarian kings. King Stephen saw value to these foreigners early on, leaving a message to his son Emmerich that a realm with one language is weak, and that foreigners must be honored and protected. In terms of foreign policy, Stephen helped his brother-in-law, Emperor Henry II, fight off King Boleslav of Poland, and he helped his new ally, Emperor Basilius II, in another war against the Bulgarians. Stephen married one of his sisters off to Doge Otto of Seoul of Venice, just mentioning that for later. When Henry II's rule ended, and the dynasty of the Holy Roman Empire shifted, Emperor Conrad II tried to invade Hungary, but was defeated. Things looked all in all bright for Hungary. Then Stephen's only living son, Emmerich, died in 1031 in a hunting accident.